Morning, everybody. This is the Senate Standing Committee on Corporations, Authorities, and Commissions. My name is Mike Ranzenhofer. I am the chair of the committee, and we are joined by our ranker, Dan Squadron, and also members Comrie and Amador. Gentlemen, thank you for being here today. Today, we are taking up for discussion the nomination of Jeffrey H. Perlman, Esquire, as director of the Authority's Budget Office. Mr. Perlman has been there in an acting position for the last 6 months, and I know that everybody's had an opportunity to review his resume. The format that we will follow this morning is Mr. Perlman will give you an opportunity to make an opening statement. Then I will have some questions for you, and other members will have some questions for you. We are not taking a vote on the nomination today. This is for discussion purposes and for you to make your presentation and answer questions from the committee. Okay, so great. Welcome. Good morning. I know that you're a veteran of Albany legislative process in many capacities, so I will turn it over to you and give you an opportunity to make an opening statement. Okay.
Thank you, Senator. Good morning, everyone. It's really an honor to be in this seat, which is somewhat new to me, having stood behind senators for quite some time. But I appreciate the opportunity to present to you today. And first, I thank Governor Cuomo for giving me the opportunity and appointing me to the position of acting director of the Authority's Budget Office. Just briefly summarizing my credentials, I have 30 sessions experience here in the legislative process, in the working for the Senate, the Assembly, and the Executive Chamber, as well as a brief period in private legal practice. I also am an adjunct professor at Albany Law School, where I teach government ethics. The ABO is a relatively new agency. I'm the first attorney to serve as the director. We're guided by a task force that is headed up by Ira Milstein, a well-regarded corporate attorney on governance matters. He's really been the lion of corporate governance for about the past 60 years. The ABO is an independent office. We're housed in the Department of State. We do not depend on taxpayer funds for our operation. And the ABO is supported through a special fee on public authorities that's assessed by the Division of Budget. Well, what does the ABO do? Our mission is to act independently to make state and local public authorities, including all state authorities, all local industrial development authorities, and hundreds of local development corporations more accountable and transparent. We help to ensure that these corporate entities act in the public interest, consistent with their intended purpose. And having an independent authorities budget office is necessary to provide that type of oversight of the operations and finance of public authorities, to inform the legislature and the executive on issues relating to debt, compensation of board members, the role that MWBE plays in the procurement process, the disposition of property, and the general governance of public authorities. How do we do this? There's approximately 600 corporate entities with a public purpose that are required to file regular reports on the ABO database, which is aptly named PARIS, the Public Authorities Reporting Information System. We share this database with the state controller, and we use the information that's posted on there to do regular compliance reviews to make sure that authorities are meeting their mission and not exceeding their debt limit, among many other things. We collect and analyze and disseminate this information to the public. We review the finance and operations of these state and local authorities. We make sure that they're compliant with state laws, that they're acting in a transparent and open manner, and that they're doing what they are authorized to do. We promote good governance principles through training and technical assistance, and we issue policy guidance, and we recommend best practices. We also have an investigatory and enforcement arm. Where we get complaints on a regular basis. We review these issues and matters, and then we make a determination whether we want to pursue it. We hear from whistleblowers, we hear from legislators, we hear from the general public and members of the press. Since arriving at the ABO in October, the office has completed 5 authority compliance reviews, and we have 2 more in the works right now. We've held 24 board member trainings with over 400 confirmed members attending. We've drafted 3 reports, and we've conducted an investigation of a public complaint that was referred to our office by the State Inspector General. And we're right now in the process of drafting our annual report that comes out in July. The ABO promotes the position of board-centered governance, meaning that we train authority board members how to be good stewards of the corporation, that they need to act in the best interest of the corporation that they've been appointed to serve, and we train them how to deal with conflicts of interest that arise, how to function in an open and transparent manner so that the public can view their workings and ensure that they serve the board's public interest. Lastly, you know, we do have in our enforcement side, we have referral powers that we can refer to local district attorneys, the attorney general, or the inspector general. And so, in closing, requiring public authorities to publish their finances, policies, plans, and decisions helps to improve transparency, review by the public, the legislature, and the executive, and the authority's budget office, facilitates the prevention of problems, not just their explanation after the problems have occurred. And I'm happy to answer the questions.
Well, again, welcome here. Thank you for being here. Thank you for your statement. I do have a couple of questions I'd like to ask you for the record. We'll go through those and then again, other questions that committee members may have. If you are confirmed, will you agree to testify upon request before this committee?
Yes.
Okay. Do you agree to provide documents, including electronic forms of communication, in a timely manner when requested by this committee, or consult with the committee regarding the basis for any good faith delay or denial of such documents?
Of course, yes.
Okay. Will you ensure that the authority complies with deadlines established for requested communications, including questions for the record and hearings?
Yes.
Okay. Have you adhered to applicable laws and regulations regarding conflicts of interest that you will face when taking the position?
Yes.
Have you assumed any duties or undertaken any actions which would appear to presume the outcome of the confirmation process?
No.
Okay. And lastly, do you agree to answer every question asked of you today truthfully and to the fullest of your ability?
Of course, yes.
Okay, well, great. One of the things that I wanted to ask you is that right now, as you testified, your office oversees many, many, both large and small authorities. And one of the things that I've seen in the past is that there's been a I don't want to classify it as large, but a significant number of authorities that do not file their reports. And there have been different schools of thought on what should happen. Should they be automatically disbanded? Should there be, you know, what should be the remedy for groups, I'll call them groups, authorities that do not file their annual reports and don't do that on a consistent basis?
Right now, the law provides for the authority's budget office to censure those non-compliant entities, those that don't file, and we have used that tool in the past for boards that have not complied in filing their reports. There are a handful of the approximately 600 authorities that report to our office that occasionally or regularly do not comply with the requirements of the statute. And our remedy has been to censure. There are other arrows in our quiver at the ABO that the statute provides for, where we may move to remove board members or move to dissolve a corporation. We haven't followed through on those to date at any particular time, but they are within the role of the authority to pursue those who are non-compliant. I would say, though, that right now, for those that aren't compliant that have not yet been censured, that censure would be the first step in that process. And a referral to one of the enforcement entities for non-compliance, since it's required by statute, and these not-for-profits or public authorities that aren't complying are in violation of the statute, there are certain remedies that other enforcement entities could take.
Do you have any not-for-profits right now that have not filed, say, for three consecutive years or more?
Yes.
So how does the censure work if they continually are non-compliant?
Well, since coming in October, I've asked the staff in my office to put together a list. We've already gotten a list of those non-compliant entities for 3 years of non-filing, and we've sent them a warning letter again in my tenure, and the process would be to move forward to censure and then to refer to other enforcement entities to put them on notice that either they comply or we're going to take further actions to either force compliance or move to disband the operation.
Okay, and not to hold you to it, but is that something that that you would expect to happen within the next 6 months?
Yes, as director, I believe it's my charge to carry out the mission of the ABO, and right now the law provides for these remedies and we plan to pursue all remedies.
Okay, how has the Not-for-Profit Revitalization Act affected the authority's office in terms of what you do?
I'm not familiar with the provisions of that statute that you're referring to, the Revitalization Act.
Okay, that was a major piece of legislation that was passed, how many years ago, 4 years ago? 2013, dealing with disclosure, whistleblowing, a whole host of things.
Oh, yes, I'm familiar with it now. Okay. Yeah, really, the ABO isn't impacted as much by that statute because it really looked at the compensation. We review under Paris, they're required to report all board member compensation as well as the staff of these public authorities. So we do review that and make sure that they're following their mission. As far as whistleblowing goes, we have policy guidance currently that states that all the public authorities in our jurisdiction are required to have a whistleblower policy and to allow for it so that there can be complaints made without fear of reprisal. And, we have the guidance that's out there, and that's how we address it.
Few more questions. You've been there for 6 months, not an overwhelmingly long time, but what improvements or changes, now that you've been there for 6 months as acting, what improvements or changes do you see yourself bringing to mold your office?
Well, as I said earlier, I'm the first attorney that's been appointed to the position of director, and it's a relatively new agency. You know, it was created in 2005 and then expanded significantly in 2009. And what I found is that many of the legal provisions, be it establishing regulations or using some of the enforcement techniques that have been provided for us in statute haven't been fully exercised. So really my goal is to use the tools that have been provided to the ABO to ensure that public authorities are transparent and accountable and using all the provisions of the statute to their fullest.
Okay, one final question. Actually, I could probably ask you questions all day, but I know that other members have questions also. But you had brought up the training that you provide. One of the things that we hear from the not-for-profit community mainly by or from lawyers that represent them is a lot of the smaller not-for-profits really have a hard time in figuring out what to do. And I was really interested that you talked about training. So how do you outreach to these smaller not-for-profits that they do this out of the goodness of their heart? I mean, they're not major or mega not-for-profits, but they provide a very valuable service to the community, but sometimes the requirements are overwhelming. So what type of outreach and training do you provide to these groups?
We do tremendous outreach and we avail ourselves. And one of the things that I've made a point of is letting these smaller entities know that we aren't just there to police, but we're also there to train and to guide and to help these local not-for-profits that were created by local government to serve a public purpose. And so it's very important when you're a public benefit corporation, regardless of your size, to follow your mission and carry out what you were established to do. And when those entities have questions, we have an open web email system. They call our office. They ask us, we have an excellent staff that fields their question, and then we discuss it internally and we provide responses. So we can be a very good resource for these smaller entities that may not have the wherewithal to hire outside counsel or the like.
Do you go into the communities or do you have webinars and things like that?
We have webinars currently, so we provide our trainings via webinar so that they don't need to travel to Albany to conduct what's required of them. And, you know, if asked, we'd be happy to go in the field. And I am in the process of developing a continuing legal education for the practitioners out there that handle these matters. But we would go to any entity that asked us and provide whatever training under the Public Authorities Reform Act that they might need.
Okay, well, thank you. I will open it up to others. Senator Squadron.
Thank you very much. I thank the chair. Thank you for being here. Look forward to you getting going. I do have a couple of questions, first about the ABO. So what's an example of a really big finding of wrongdoing and the ABO's reaction to it, in either in your 6 months or in its life?
Well, in the last 6 months, I've been to a couple of closing report meetings where boards have acted not necessarily in the best interests of the public, where we've had to correct them and give them guidance to reform.
Any examples? Are they not public?
No, they're public.
So what's a good example?
An example would be where a board,
Which one for, I mean, a specific example.
The name of the board escapes me. It was an upstate local development corporation where management was essentially operating and what appeared to be a way that the board was not aware of the management's activities. And what fleshed out in the conversations were that the board needed to better reflect in its minutes its operation, how it was presented the issue by management, how it made a determination to act, and to have management then carry out that decision. It wasn't well reflected in the minutes of the meeting, so only after an inquiry and review did we find that the process was done properly, but it wasn't reflected properly, that the minutes didn't reflect the activities of the board. And what we encourage is transparency. So in our report, we said that when management comes to the board with a matter, that the board needs to act on it and reflect its actions in the minutes, be it through a resolution and a vote or through some other determination that then makes the management carry out their activity. They just need to reflect that better in the minutes. But let me give you a better example that predates me of the ABO's activities that led to a positive result for the public. New Power Corporation in Monroe County was a local development corporation that was created by the county government to transfer an asset, a power plant, from the county's holdings in Monroe County to this local development corporation. And it was there was bid rigging involved in the sense that the new entity got an appraisal of the power plant that was highly inflated, and they used that appraisal to purchase the power plant from the county, and then used some of the additional assets to give to the county a higher value so that the county could clean up an operating deficiency. And someone called our office and tipped us off to that activity, and we did a cursory investigation and determined wrongdoing and referred it to the Attorney General's office. To make a long story short, the bid rigging was found, people were found to have committed crimes, they were prosecuted, they went to jail. Then the properties that were created and moved from the county to the local Development Corporation had to be reverted back. So there was legislation that reverted that property back to the locality, and then we had to dissolve these corporations. And the ABO worked with the Attorney General's office in Supreme Court to move to remove the board members, to move to dissolve the corporation. And so we brought everything back to the county. So there's an opportunity where someone blew the whistle on this entity. They brought it to the right agency, and the agency knew what to do with that information in the sense that we brought it to the Attorney General's office for criminal prosecution, and then worked with them civilly to shut the operation down and move it back to the way it was.
Great. So things like bid rigging, malfeasance in contracting are well within the ABO's mission.
When those matters are brought to our attention, yes, we know how to deal with those matters, yes.
But the ABO was not involved in any of the sort of higher profile suggestions of that happening over the last year or 2 years in Albany that, you know, have hit the newspapers statewide?
No.
Do you think that's like, do you see that as an issue, or do you see that as outside the mission of the ABO?
I see it as an issue in the sense that it deals with matters that the ABO traditionally handles. However, the issues that you refer to are matters of higher education, and right now that's not in our enabling statute, so we don't have jurisdiction over those matters.
And do you believe that within your jurisdiction, the ABO, or let me ask the question differently, how do you see the ABO being organized to catch those sorts of issues within your jurisdiction?
Well, we have whistleblower provisions in the ABO statute, so we encourage and we require all the boards that report to us to have a whistleblower protection policy. And we hear from the public and the press and the legislators. So we believe that there is an opportunity at the onset to refer matters to our office.
Great, I appreciate that. And then just, you serve at the pleasure of the governor, or is it a fixed term?
It's upon confirmation, it's a 4-year fixed term.
Great, because, you know, I think that one issue, going back to the passage of the statute under a previous administration, previous majority in the Senate, I actually believe, Mr. Chair, there's a lot of a ballyhoo about it and enthusiasm, excitement. I was certainly among those very excited about it. You know, I think one challenge as a structural matter that's been identified is it's a gubernatorially appointed job overseeing in many cases, not in the case of local development corporations, but in many cases, public authorities and corporations that are also gubernatorially appointed. And when you talk about the ones that are most important in my constituents' lives, the MTA, which is almost daily, making it exceedingly difficult for my constituents to get to work. In fact, yesterday I told them not to go to work. And the Port Authority, which is redeveloping the World Trade Center site in my district and runs the Red Hook Piers. We've talked about this before, I just sort of for the record, what's your vision of how to maintain independence, how to, without fear or favor, really be able to, in an aggressive and effective way, make the mission of the ABO a reality?
Thank you, Senator. Well, the law was designed for the ABO to be independent, which is why they create this confirmation process, so that upon confirmation, it is truly an independent office. Currently, as acting, I am an appointee of the governor. I appreciate the governor's faith in me to carry out the mission of the ABO, and I would say today, just like post-confirmation, I plan to carry out the mission of the ABO and fulfill that mission by utilizing what's been provided to me in statute.
Do you see a conflict along the lines of those concerns that have been raised over the years about the ABO?
No, I think the law is clear that it provides for independence, and I plan to follow the law.
Great. I hope aggressively and wherever it leads you.
I know no other way, Senator.
I actually know that to be true. I've had the pleasure of working with you in multiple different ways over many years, and I know you to have high level of integrity, share a quality with me that sometimes gets us into trouble, which is a true anger at malfeasance or inefficiency at the government level, deep down in our core, and I'm excited for you to play that role and expand it through the ABO, which, you know, I have to say is a positive organization, has been run with integrity to this point. I'd like to see it have a bigger footprint and a bigger shadow cast over public authorities and corporations that I think today too often operate as if there is no oversight entity. And the ABO is that entity, and with you at its helm, I'm sure we'll all remember it.
Thank you, Senator.
Senator Cormier, any questions?
I don't have any questions for Mr. Furman. I wish him good luck. I never had the pleasure of working with you because when I came, you were leaving to the Senate to go to the Lieutenant Governor, but I see your record and know your history and know of the high esteem that many people have put in you, and I congratulate the Governor for having the foresight and the understanding that you will do a good job at the ABO and hopefully take it to the next levels to make sure that all of the vast authorities and corporations and oversight is taken to a level that will help all of us, actually, because I have a lot of questions about how I can help individual boards in Queens to do better, to make sure that they're following practices and procedures. And if we can utilize the ABO to help them, I hope that that can happen on a higher level under your leadership. I'm sure it will. A lot of people have faith in you, and I just want to say congratulations.
Thank you, Senator. I look forward to working with you.
Look forward to it.
Mr. Comrie, another question I have was kind of piggybacking on some of the things that have been brought up in terms of the role of your office and maybe an expanded role. Is it your judgment that in order to increase the scope or the role of your office that there would have to be some statutory fixes for that? And if so, what is your suggestion in terms of what needs to be amended in statute to give your office greater authority to deal with some other issues that perhaps should be dealt with?
Well, right now, I think that the statute as written provides us with the tools that we need to carry out our mission. I think if the legislature saw fit to expand that role, we would fulfill it. We would carry out that mission.
Well, sure you would, but what is your position? Should it be expanded into what areas? I mean, if there was going to be an expansion, into what areas should it be expanded?
Well, I think generally, we do oversee these local public benefit corporations, and there are some that don't fit in, that seem to carry out the mission that we oversee. However, because of the way the statute is written, we don't have, the ABO does not have jurisdiction over them. So if we were to be included, if those other economic development, public benefit, public authorities were to be included, we would have no problem handling the oversight and the guidance that we provide current public authorities.
Well, I also want to thank you for your attendance here today. I don't want to be presumptuous, but do you have anybody with you that you wanted to introduce?
My daughter, Sophia Perlman, is here. My partner, Susan Petto, is here. I see my son, Kyle Perlman, is here, and other friends and acquaintances and colleagues.
Okay. Well, I want to give you that opportunity and to
thank
the
you.
Friends and family that are here. You presented yourself very well today. Very impressed with your resume. I think the governor has made a good choice. We look forward to moving forward with this. So thank you for being here today, and thank you for your testimony.
Thank you for your time. Appreciate
okay.
it. Thank
Great.
The committee.
Okay.